Good morning. Welcome to worship on this fifth Sunday of Lent as we continue to walk the journey all the way to the cross. Whether you are a longtime member or a visitor with us today, whether in person or online, we say welcome to Christ Lutheran Church in Blaine, Minnesota. Please take note of the Holy Week schedule in your bulletin. Today is the Fed and Forgiven retreat here at Christ Lutheran. It is not just for First Communion families, it is for all ages. And you'll also note that there is a form on the back table in the narthex where you can indicate flowers that you would like to order for Easter. Last week we had a wonderful conversation with our Bishop Ann Svenningsen of the Minneapolis Area Synod about the upcoming call process. This is your chance to nominate a candidate for consideration by the call committee. It is a bright green sheet. It is on the back table also. There are also envelopes there for you, or you can put it in any envelope. These forms are confidential. These candidates are serving other congregations across the country. So this is a confidential process, and we hope that you will take that into consideration. At this time, I would like to invite Tim Devaney up with a special word for you about a special appeal.
So this week, if you didn't already receive it, or this coming week, you'll receive a letter and a new pledge card for our upcoming campaign. This is a generosity campaign to make up the difference that we had in our budget that you passed back in January at the annual meeting. The amount that we're hoping for or shooting for is at least $122,000. That was our gap that we had in our budget at that time. So how this will work is your existing pledge will continue on as it is that you made last fall. This will be added to that pledge for ministry and outreach. So when you receive your statement and you look at your amount, the two will be added together. Otherwise, there's no way for us to know which one you'd be giving towards when you give to ministry and outreach. So we want to make sure that we're bringing the two together, and then overall, you essentially have one large pledge then that would be include the two. So the cards are on the table in the back, along with envelopes. You can complete them, drop them off in the box back there, or you can mail them in, but you'll also receive one in the mail as well. Certainly want to thank you all for your past and future gifts to Christ Lutheran Church. This is such a significant request. We hate doing a second appeal, but the challenge is, unless we understand where we're going to be with our budget and our ongoing giving for the rest of the year, it makes it that much more difficult for us to plan and ensure that we are going to have the gifts to cover our expenses and our needs. So again, thank you for your past and your future gifts, and hope that you will pledge as we move forward. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I would invite the congregation to please rise for the greeting and opening prayer. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Creator God, you prepare a new way in the wilderness, and your grace waters our desert. Open our hearts to be transformed by the new thing you are doing, that our lives may proclaim the extravagance of your love, given to all through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen.
Good morning. As you may know, we have been hearing from the organizations who received $5,000 this spring from Christ Lutheran's 60th anniversary mission fund appeal. I have to admit, I was really thrilled to be able to give $5,000 to Family Promise in Anoka County. In 2009, a group of concerned residents and community leaders saw a need for a response to the growing problem of family homelessness. I was one of those, and as the outreach director of Christ Lutheran, you supported me being on the leadership team that formed the organization. I served as the first president on their board of directors, and Family Promise opened its doors to guest families in the fall of 2010. Thank you, Christ Lutheran, for believing in the dream we had and supporting it through the years. Before we go to the video of David Fry, executive director, I want to say a huge thank you to Sue Witt and Janet Beto and all the volunteers from Christ Lutheran who have given countless hours to help host families here in the church building overnight for a week at a time, four times a year, until the pandemic changed all of our lives. Now here's David.
Greetings, I'm David Fry from Family Promise in Anoka County, and I want to say thank you so much for your continued support of Family Promise and the work that we do helping families that are struggling with housing insecurity. Throughout this pandemic, we have really appreciated the support of our member congregations, Christ especially, as we have worked for so many ways to keep our project moving. And although there have been some difficulties along the way, we have found an opportunity to grow and expand our offerings to better serve families in our community. We have added stability programs for families after they exit shelter, and we have added a prevention program that also helps us to keep people out of shelter in the first place. We continue to work toward a static site where families will have one place to live and to stay and be secure in a space. But until then, we continue to use a hotel model to shelter families that are in our program and help them achieve housing stability. Thanks again for your support, for your continued partnership with us at Family Promise, and we appreciate the work that you do. Thanks.
Dwell in the Hey everyone, good morning. It's time for our children's message, so I invite all you children of God, whether you're 0 or 99, or you're here in the sanctuary or online, to just scoot a little bit closer in your seat. And I'm wondering if anyone can tell me what this wonderful bag I'm holding right here is. I see a hand, a wonderful hand. What is it? Popcorn, you're right, this is microwave popcorn. It is a wonderful thing. And how might you know that this popcorn is popped? Well, there's a couple of ways. You might stand at the microwave looking in as it runs and see the bag expanding with your eyes. You might listen with your ears and hear it popping. Or my favorite one, you might smell the popcorn. When you pop popcorn, it kind of fills the whole house, doesn't it, with that wonderful smell. But we don't actually see the popcorn popping, but we use our senses to know that it is, right? And in today's story, the disciples walk into this room where Jesus is eating a meal. And they can totally sense this new life that just surrounds Jesus. They smell this oil that's being poured on him. They hear him talking. They see Lazarus, who's just been raised from the dead. And there's just this new life that's abundant and surrounding him. And we can kind of see that in our sanctuary, too, and the people sitting next to us. And that big cross up on the wall and these candles and communion. There's so many things that we can see God's new life in. Isn't that cool? Let's pray together. Dear God, thank you for dying and being raised to life so that we might be raised to new life in you. Help us to see the new life that abounds all around us this spring. In your name we pray. Amen.
The first reading is taken from Isaiah 43, verses 16 through 21. Thus says the Lord, who makes a way in the sea, a path in the mighty waters, who brings out chariot and horse, army and warrior. They lie down, they cannot rise. They are extinguished, quenched like a wick. Do not remember the former things or consider the things of old. I am about to do a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it? I will make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. The wild animals will honor me, the jackals and the ostriches. For I give water in the wilderness, rivers in the desert, to give drink to my chosen people, the people whom I formed for myself, so that they might declare my praise. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Free.
We rise for the reading of the Gospel. The Holy Gospel for this day comes to us from John, the 12th chapter. 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, the home of Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. There they gave a dinner for him. Martha served, and Lazarus was one of those at the table with him. Mary took a pound of costly perfume made of pure nard, anointed Jesus' feet, and wiped them with her hair. The house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume. But Judas Iscariot, one of his disciples, the one who was about to betray him, said, "Why was this perfume not sold for 300 denarii and the money given to the poor?" He said this not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. He kept the common purse and used to steal what was put into it. Jesus said, "Leave her alone. She bought it so that she might keep it for the day of my burial. You always have the poor with you, but you do not always have me." The Gospel of the Lord.
Good morning. It's so good to see all of you here and to have all of you online listening to church this morning. It is just wonderful. And I want to say thank you to Pastor Joy for giving me this time today, which would normally be her time to speak with you. So I really appreciate that. So I'd like to start out by telling you how much I love this church. And certainly a part of that is the structure itself, the sanctuary, the cross that Walt made. But more than that, it is all of you and how much I love you. Our family has had a great history at this church. Ann and I and our three young daughters at the time, I think they were ages 1 to 5, joined about 33 years ago. And what an experience it's been for us. Our kids have grown up here. They went to Sunday school here. They went to mission trips here. They performed in youth musicals here. Ann and I have volunteered in numerous ways here. It has been a great experience. And there have been tremendous, mostly times of awesome experience, of good things happening, but sometimes of struggle. But in all of those, we have always been thankful to be here with you. You know, so one thing I want to say is that as I'm here and I'm speaking to you, I'm not just speaking to you. I have a mirror in front of me, and I see myself, and I speak to myself as well as you. But I think, imagine this wall behind me is a huge mirror, and we're all looking in that mirror and the reflections of ourself. And we're sitting side by side next to one another, and we're in this together. So what else do you see in that mirror? You see someone who's young, someone that's old or older, right? We see someone that's sitting alone or someone that's sitting with family or friends. You see someone who's hurting and in need of healing. You see someone next to them who's content and ready to move forward. Do you see someone who's worried about our future? And someone behind them who looks forward to that future with great anticipation? So we've heard that the two greatest commandments are to love the Lord our God with all our heart, mind, and soul. Right? And the next is to love our neighbors as ourselves. And in fact, in our vision here, we say that we live the love of Christ here in our church. So given, in light of that, right, there's room for all of us here. With the differences that I've mentioned, no matter what the color of your skin, your sexual preference, your sexual identity, whether you're poor or rich, it doesn't matter. There's room for all of us. So in that case, shouldn't the people who are content and ready to move forward embrace and support those who need healing and to listen to them? And shouldn't those people who are in need of healing embrace and support those who are ready to move forward and to listen to them? Do you see a child of God in that mirror? Everyone I see here, I see is a child of God. Do you see anyone who's blessed? Everyone I see is blessed. This church is truly blessed. So in this Lenten period, we follow the travels of Christ to Easter. So he starts out relatively modestly in a manger. And there are few who think they know who he is. And some of them bring him gifts. And others set out to kill him in his infancy. As a young boy, he's in the temple squares and he's speaking. And he's a bit of a child prodigy. They're amazed at what he knows about the scriptures and his wisdom at such a young age before he's even been taught. And as time goes on, he gathers his team of disciples. His followers increase in numbers. And things are going pretty well. But as he matures, and his teaching becomes more direct, it conflicts with the elite leadership of the Jewish faith. And there's some rejection that starts to intermingle with the admiration. And then that rejection becomes betrayal, becomes persecution, and then becomes physical abuse, right? He's beaten, he's whipped, he's nailed to a cross like that, and he's left there to suffer until he dies. Can you imagine sacrificing your son or your daughter in the death of Christ? But this is all done by God, right? He loves us so much that he gave his only son to die for us so that our sins would be forgiven and we could have eternal life with him. And through his grace, he says, what? It's free. All we have to do is accept his son, and all that is free. But wow, at what cost? His son sacrificed. Knowing that, how can we ever feel anything but blessed? I don't think we can, right? So a couple weeks ago, I was talking about change and how I think change is one of the most constant things in our life, right? That after God's love for us, it might be the most constant thing. I mean, things are always changing on us or for us or whatever the case might be. So consider the degree of change that Christ was bringing to the world and the resistance that he encountered in doing that. Can you imagine what things would be like if he didn't succeed? But he did. So Christ has died and now he's risen. So who's in place to carry things forward? Can you imagine if the early disciples of Christ were so afraid, they're so worried, they're so focused on their need to mourn that loss and for the healing that they decide not to fulfill their mission, which of course is to spread the good news of Christ? Where would we be today? Not likely here, right? So in Paul's letter to the Romans, he's talking about how he rejoices in his suffering. He's like, really? Are you kidding me? Why? Because he knows that all those things, the suffering, the challenges, the crisis, require so much more from us than when times are good. It's how we grow. Right? So in dealing with those situations and persevering through those situations, right, we can still continue to focus on what God is calling us to do. Excuse me here a second. So, and through that process, we grow, right? Our character gets stronger, and it results in hope. But hope is not where things end. It's where they begin. If all we have is hope, we get nowhere. But when hope results in a heart, in a mind, in an attitude that allows us to pursue our purposes that God has for us, that is something. And that's what we can do here. I know we can do that here. God knows that we can do that here. Right? So where do we go from here? I think we work together to create a new story, a new chapter, right, in the history of our church. And there's a number of ways to do that, right? But one of the things that we're asking you to do now is to dig down deeper and give more. As Tim had mentioned, we passed a budget in at the annual meeting in January, and we knew there was a deficit there, right? So we knew that we were going to have to do something about it. Or I guess we could choose to do nothing about it, but that's not an option, right? So I would ask you this, though. Don't look at this as a deficit reduction. I mean, how boring is that? Right? I mean, what kind of motivation do we get from that? But look at this as a way for us to sow seeds of growth, to allow ourselves to continue to live the love of Christ, to provide the ministries that we do and to grow them, to help those who are less fortunate than us, to pursue God's purposes for us. That's what we're talking about. Not a budget deficit. We're talking about those things. And as Tim said, I want to thank you so much for everything that you have given over the years and this year and what you've committed to. Without it, we wouldn't be in good shape at all. But I know we have it within us to do more. I have always felt, like Tim has said many times, how generous we are. But sometimes I've wondered, do we underachieve a little bit? And I think when you look back 3 years ago when we did the appeal for the 60th anniversary, I think we answered that question. Yeah. We got more in us than what we normally do. We can do this. So I think it opened up our minds, our hearts, and our faith to really what our possibilities are going forward. So there's a couple of verses in the book of Matthew relative to our relationship with God and money. And one talks about, you know, we can't serve God and money at the same time. So I retired at the end of December after 30 years in the wealth management business. So I worked with people managing their money. But much more than that, I always looked at it as my purpose being to help them fulfill their purpose, right? And certainly money maybe was an aspect of that, but it was how do we utilize this to benefit what we believe in, what we love, and not allow it to control us, right? And that's the way I look at that. Money is never an end. It has no place like that in our lives. But it is a way, it is a means, right, to help us focus on the things that are important to us, to make a difference, to live with that purpose. And the other verse says that, well, where your treasure is, your heart will be also. And I think so true, right? So you could look at that, it's like a chicken and the egg question, right? Which one came first? Well, I put my treasure and then my heart went there, or was my heart there, and then so my treasures followed. And it can be either one. And it doesn't matter, because in the end, the statement's true. Wherever that treasure is, that's where our heart truly is. And I know for me, and I think probably for all of you, right, that has always been here first and foremost. And it's not to say there's many ways that we can utilize our money to help support and give purpose and help people in need and make a significant difference, absolutely. But given what we know, what God did for us, the sacrifices of his son, for me, I mean, this is number one. Right? This is where we put most of our resources, gladly, in celebration. You know, we think sometimes about when we buy something for ourselves, nothing wrong with that, by the way, but how excited we can get if it's a new cabin or a truck or a car or a four-wheeler or giving the gift to somebody, and those are wonderful things. And I hope you feel the same way when you make that gift here. You should. It's so much better. So much better. I'm so confident that we can do this, right, because of who's in support of us and who's leading us. God is giving us everything that we need. Himself, his son, ourselves, and our resources. All we have to do is choose him. And it's a done deal. So I want to finish with a story. It's a story that played out on a golf course, but it's really not about golf. So every year there's a tournament in the PGA Tour called the Waste Management Phoenix Open. And that tournament takes place in early February, usually around the time of the Super Bowl. And the course it's played on is called the TPC Stadium Course. And it's given that name because on the 16th hole, which is a par 3, the entire length of the hole, starting from behind the tee box, down the length of the hole, around the green, is a stadium. And it holds 4,000, 5,000, 6,000 people. It's the only hole of its kind in all of golf around the world. Men and women alike. Because you know, the normal etiquette in golf is, you know, you got to be really quiet when somebody hits the ball and this and that, but not on this hole. People are cheering and jeering and clapping and laughing and having a great time, and the players expect it. So in 2019, Gary Woodland was coming to play this hole. He had won the tournament the year before. And a couple weeks before, he had been contacted by the PGA. They're huge supporters of all sorts of charities. And this one was relative to a young lady whose name is Amy, who was born with Down syndrome. And Amy just idolized Gary Woodland, loved him. And so there was an arrangement made, unbeknownst to her, that she would meet Gary Woodland on this hole. So her parents brought her there, and they introduced her to him, and she's excited. And, you know, they're mic'd up. They have a radio or TV people around, and there's mics there, and the fans are hearing all of this, right? And then Gary says, "Well, do you want to play with me?" She's a golfer, Down syndrome, but she's a golfer. She's pretty good. And she's excited, and they have the shoes for her. They have a glove. They brought her clubs. Her parents are with her. And in an interview I saw later with her mom, they talked about how they've raised her with no limits. And so she's getting ready. She gets on the tee, and the crowd is cheering for her and clapping. And she hits the drive. It's about 165-yard par 3 hole. Hits a nice shot, but ends up just short of the green in a sand trap, right? Not the easiest thing for an amateur to hit out of. But on the tee, people are cheering for her, and she says to Gary, "They love me. The people love me." And they're walking down the length of the hole towards where her ball is, and Gary says, "Well, do you want to hit it out of there? Do you want me to hit?" No, she says, "I got this. I got this." And you can hear in the mic as they walk towards the sand trap where she is, she says, "You can do this. You can do this." And she gets up there, and she's in the sand trap, and she hits it out, and she hits the ball within 8 feet of the hole. I mean, she's never played in front of 2,000 or 3,000 people before. They're cheering, and she hits the shot. Pretty good shot, but 8 feet is not a gimme. Even the pros at 8 feet are going to miss maybe 50% of those putts. So Gary's up there talking with her. He says, "Well, I think it's going to go a little bit this way." And she says, "I got this." And she gets up and she hits the putt and she sinks it for a par. And the crowd is just going crazy. It is fabulous. So what does she show you? No fear. Nothing but courage. A huge heart surrounded by love. Just like us. So in Amy's words, "We got this." Right? No problem. We got this. So in closing, may the God that we know and worship in Jesus Christ go before you to guide you, behind you to encourage you, beside you as your friend, above you to protect you, and within you to give joy and meaning to all of life. Amen.
I'm amazed by you. I'm amazed by you. Lord, I'm amazed by you. How you love me. You paint the morning sky with miracles in my mind. My hope will always stand as you hold me in your hand. Lord, I'm amazed by you. Lord, I'm amazed by you. Lord, I'm amazed by you. How you love me. How wide, how deep, how great.
Drawn close to the heart of God, we offer these prayers for the church, the world, and all who are in need. Do a new thing in the church, O God. Free us from paradigms that no longer serve the gospel and bring forward leaders who imagine fresh ways of doing ministry. Give us courage in the face of change. Merciful God, do a new thing for creation. Reverse the trajectory of climate change and environmental catastrophe. Revive habitats already impaired by human disregard. Amplify the voices of climate scientists and researchers working to chart a new course. Merciful God, do a new thing in our world. Break barriers that prevent political enemies from working together for the well-being of all. Make a way for peace and collaboration among the nations. Be with the people of Ukraine, O God. Enfold them with your love. Merciful God, do a new thing for those who suffer. Reveal a path for any who are unemployed or underemployed, for those experiencing homelessness, and for all who struggle with money. Comfort those who grieve and restore those who are sick. Especially in our midst, we remember Kimberly Deleen, Sue Stowe, David Voss, Barb Wielander, and all we now name before you in the silence of our hearts. Merciful God, do a new thing in our death. Fill us with the knowledge of Christ and the power of his resurrection as we give thanks for all the saints who have attained the prize of their heavenly call. Merciful God, accept the prayers we bring, O God, on behalf of a world in need for the sake of Jesus Christ. Amen. And now hear the words of institution. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks. broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. The table is set. All are welcome. You may be seated.
I'm
One final word from President Mark Vachigalupo.
I apologize, but I forgot something. So there are a lot of people in leadership in this congregation, right, both formally and informally. But last week I asked your council, who was a formal leader in the congregation, to consider what they could do relative to this appeal, and asked them to do that so I could tell you today so that we could get a feel for where we're at with that leadership. And I can tell you they are extremely committed to this congregation, to our future, to working with all of you to move things forward. And they have committed to increasing their pledge, what they're giving is going to be this year, by $45,800 to this point. So it's a great start. We're going to do this together, though. We're going to finish it. But I want to thank them for what they've done, stepping forward as they have. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Now we rise for the blessing. You are children of God, anointed with the oil of gladness and strengthened for the journey. Almighty God, motherly, majestic, and mighty, bless you this day and always. Amen. Go in peace. Jesus meets you on the way. Thanks be to God.